in all parts of the world, the war in Vietnam. I believe that one of the reasons for the deep division about Vietnam is that many Americans have lost confidence in what their government has told them about our policy. The American people cannot and should not be asked to support a policy which involves the overriding issues of war and peace unless they know the truth about that policy. Tonight, therefore, I would like to answer some of the questions that I know are on the minds of many of you listening to me. How and why did America get involved in Vietnam in the first place? How has this administration changed the policy of the previous administration? What has really happened in negotiations in Paris on the battlefront of Vietnam? What choices do we have if we are to end the war? What are the prospects for peace? Now let me begin by describing the situation I found when I was inaugurated on January 20th. The war had been going on for 4 years. 31,000 Americans had been killed in action. The training program for the South Vietnamese was beyond schedule. 540,000 Americans were in Vietnam with no plans to reduce the number. No progress had been made at the negotiations in Paris, and the United States had not put forth a comprehensive peace proposal. The war was causing deep division at home and criticism from many of our friends as well as our enemies abroad. In view of these circumstances, there were some who urged that I end the war at once by ordering the immediate withdrawal of all American forces. From a political standpoint, this would have been a popular and easy course to follow.
We were told that we would see America come and go. And in a sense, America is dying from within. Because they forgot the instructions on how to live on Earth. We are all from the Earth. And when the Earth, the water, the atmosphere is corrupted, then it will create its own reaction. Mother is reacting. In the Hopi prophecy, they say the storms and floods will become greater. To me, it's not a negative thing to know that there will be great changes. It's not negative. It's evolution. When you look at it as evolution, it's time. Nothing stays the same.
Now this is the final lap for the 10,000 meter. The unheralded Mahou Kabuti of Tunis is putting on a tremendous sprint. He's out ahead of Ron Clark, Bill Mills, the United States is in third place. This will certainly be the fastest 10,000 meter ever won by an American. Here they come down the final lap. Ken Ron Clark, Ken Kabuti, they're going through the field. He's coming up. He's passing Kabuti.
Look at Bill!
Bill is coming on!
Oh, no!
It might be Bill!
Where it comes,
Matthews is
behind
him!
Bill
takes the win!
them the drugs, builds bigger prisons, passes a three-strike law, and then wants us to sing God Bless America? No, no, no. Not God Bless America. God damn America. That's in the Bible for killing innocent people. God damn America for treating our citizens as less than human. God damn America. As long as she
thank you. mess me up. You want to screw up the works. You want to blow my book sales in New York. There's a bluebird in my heart that wants to get out. But I'm too clever. I'm going to let him out at night sometimes when everybody's asleep. I say, I know you're there, so don't be sad. And then I put him back. And he's singing. I haven't quite let him die. Sleep together like that. Without a secret pact.
this is probably going to anger a few of you uncles and alcoholics, if you sell out, if you hang around the horses you used to be called in the old days. And I really don't give a damn, because I deep down really cause a little disturbance. The crazy horse and Geronimo and a few of these other great leaders we had could see the pathetic conditions we're living under today. I'm sure they would turn over their graves.
American Indians are becoming militant, demanding the government take action to help solve their problems of poverty and discrimination. 1,500 Indians are in Albuquerque, parading and making their demands known to the National Congress of American Indians. The administration is aware of this new militancy.
The federal government's Indian policies have been continuing national failure of major proportions. These policies have swung between harsh policies of starving the Indians into submission or kinder policies of helping them become non-Indian.
Now, I would have to agree that these policies have been less than effective.
They say they have a right to the land.
Yes, and it's never been finally determined in the courts or by the means that are open. As to just who does own the land, it's still in litigation.
Do you think maybe that's why you're letting him stay there?
There's a 50% chance they're right. It is there. So that does give them possibly a little bit more of a right than you and I might have.
Ohio River, sir. About 200 miles. down the river once when I was a kid. There's a place in the river I can't remember. Must have been a gardenia plantation or flower plantation at one time. Wild and overgrown now, but for about 5 miles, it's like the heaven just fell in the earth in the form of gardenias.
Truly enemies.